this journey of going through all the miracles that Jesus did seemed to be a bit tedious, because we've been at it for a while. We've been doing two every Sunday, and we're just at 18 and 19. So next week, we'll be halfway through. It is incredible that we have 40 miracles of Jesus in the Bible, considering that the number 40, it's a number of completion. It's also the number of a generation. So I firmly believe that God was telling us something. Now, many of you probably thought in the beginning of the study that it is required that each person has faith before they're healed. How many thought that? Well, I know more than one person thought. Every time you're going to pray for somebody, because my mom was sick with cancer, and when they prayed for her, they told her, you just don't have enough faith. And I wasn't a Christian then, but I already knew that was wrong. I already knew my mom was full of faith. My mom had more faith than anybody else I knew. So it wasn't a matter of faith. Today we're going to deal with 18 and 19, and they're kind of unique because they are found each only in one gospel. The others are normally found in three gospels. Each one of these are found in only in one. So turn with me to Matthew chapter 9. Matthew the tax collector. Matthew was one that got to see the stuff for himself. He was not writing what someone else said. He was writing what he saw himself. Matthew chapter 9, verse 32. While they were going out, a man who was demon-possessed and could not talk was brought to Jesus. And when the demon was driven out, the man who had been mute spoke. The crowd was amazed and said, nothing like this has ever been seen in Israel. Now, look how the church of the day responds. But the Pharisees said, it is by the prince of demons that he drives out devils. Now, who brought the man to Jesus? Anyone who was listening. It does says who brought him. Who? It's right there. The verse 32. Who brought him? The people. The people brought him. Did the person have faith? That it says that the people had faith. They didn't mention anything about faith. No, it didn't. We do know that we have to have faith to please God. But sometimes we limit things because we want to try to understand. We want to try to understand miracles. Understand this about miracles. They're called miracles because you cannot understand them. If you're able to rationalize a miracle, it is no longer a miracle. Plainly put, he was dead, now he lives. How did that happen? I don't know. Oh, well, he wasn't really dead, you know. He was just in a coma somewhere, and then all of a sudden he got up. Yeah, you can see that happen to Lazarus, right? Lazarus, come forth. Loose him and let him go. Why did I do that little thing? Because Lazarus had to hop out. He couldn't walk out. Did I lose anybody? See, they had this ritual after someone died. They kind of put perfume on them, different herbs on them, and they wrapped them up. So when they opened that rock and Jesus speaks Lazarus' name, by the way, Lazarus was a common name. It's still a common name in Mexico. If I were to go to Mexico City right now and say, Lazarus, I'll have a whole bunch of people turn around. You calling me? See, it was a common name in Jesus' time too. And Jesus didn't say Lazarus Smith or Lazarus William. You know, their last name was considered the city they were from. So when he said, Lazarus, come forth, here comes someone coming out, and they're all wrapped up. And what Jesus said, lose them. Wait a second. Why couldn't he lose himself? See, when we get to that miracle, we'll deal with it more. intently. But here it is, people brought this man. They did not know why he couldn't speak. None of them knew that. It brought up and Jesus cast out that demon. And then the man began to speak. Wait, Jesus did not consider the man's sickness. How did he know? See, here's what we know about how miracles happen. We try to have a pattern. If you go to Benny Hinn, Benny Hinn has his pattern. Watch him. You see, he has his pattern. Does the same thing over and over. You go to TD Jakes, same pattern. Everyone has a pattern that they do. Anyone has found a pattern in the 18 miracles that we have done. There is no pattern. There's nothing that do this every time, it will work. So why is it that we get stuck in a pattern? This is why. Because we did it one time, it worked. So we try again the second time. And it probably worked the second time. So we got stuck on a pattern. And we tried every time. But Jesus had to have insight of this person that was possessed. As a man walked up to him, he had to understand the man could talk. By the way, the man could talk. Wait, does the Bible say the man could talk? Well, when the demon was no longer there, he talked. Which means he had to be able to talk. The problem was that the demon got in the way. There are times in your life that there are things that are in the way that are stopping you from doing what you're supposed to do. So you have to go to the root of the matter. Go down to when it started. Is it ironic that even science does that? Tell me when it started. Oh, well, I don't remember. I was 2 years old. Does your mom know when it started? We have to go to the root of the cause. Sometimes, pretty much all the time, we are in 2015, so we have a headache. What do we go get? Most doctors recommend Tylenol. Does Tylenol take away your headache? Chris, it doesn't. What does Tylenol do to you? It masks the symptoms. Wait. I don't have a headache no more, but you still really do have a headache. You just can't feel it. We do that as Christians. We want patch me up. Make me better so I can work tomorrow. I don't have time to deal with this. Give me a quick fix. See, we live in that era right now. Fix me. Well, the problem is you have a spirit issue. Oh, no, I don't. I don't have any spirit issues. No, no, I know what that means. I don't have a spirit issue. Yeah, you do. You keep entertaining certain things, and those things now have you entertained. It stops you from doing certain things. Like, this stops this man from being able to do the normal function of the tongue. His speak. Now, the moment that demon was no longer there, what was normal became normal again. He opened his mouth and began to speak. And this is what the people said. We have never seen this before. Wait. We didn't take Tylenol. We have never seen a person not have a headache without Tylenol. How did you do that? You just touched the person and they don't have a headache no more. That's better than Tylenol. What did you do? Well, I just saw the root of the problem. How many of you have issues? I think everybody's hand should have gone up, because mine included. Everybody has issues. So, dealing with our issues, we have to get to the bottom of them. I have some young men that are in Ms. Donna's class, well, one particular, I already told him the root of his issue. I said, here's your problem. You're lazy. It's an easy fix for me. Is that the problem? How do we fix it? We get up in the morning and get going. Right? Easy fix. I'm lazy. Alarm. Bah, 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 bah. Snooze. Bah, 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 bah. Snooze. Bah, bah. Snooze. Bah, bah, ah. We did not fix the problem. All we did with the problem was now we made it worse. Because the poor alarm is now broken. The thing that would encourage us to get up is now silent. Easy fix. Made it more difficult. As time progressed, becoming lazy becomes a personality. That's part of who they are. They are lazy. So easy fix. I'm thinking easy fix. Do you know everybody in here has the potential of being lazy? Everybody does. Why is it some people have more hours in a day than most people have? Don't we have the same amount? Well, unless you were like me on the plane coming from Amsterdam where it still continues, I get up, left, and one day and return, and one day, like 4 hours later, even though I had been in the plane for 14 hours, go figure. Everybody does have the same amount of hours, but have you realized some people do more with those times? And if you've ever noticed that, because I know people look at me, how do you do it, Pastor? I'm not lazy, but I want to be. What? Did he say what I thought he said? I want to be lazy. How many of you understand what I'm talking about? It's like, I'm tired. I want to stay in bed. But there's something inside of me that tells me you need to get up. It was that thing that I nourished for most of my life. Yeah, I gave that thing enough sustenance that the thing overpowers my body and puts one leg out. And by the time I put that one leg out, the other one has to follow. And have you ever gotten out of bed and realized you're walking to the bathroom and don't remember how you got to the bathroom? Saying, oh my God, this force really works. It becomes a pattern. You end up getting up and doing stuff. How about this? You arrived and don't remember ever stopping at a red light. Any of you ever done that? See what happens? It becomes a pattern now. Your pattern is different than being lazy. Your pattern is a doing pattern. How about this next one? That you're going somewhere and end up somewhere else because this is what you'd usually do every day. You see, our body created a pattern. So you can also create a pattern of doing the wrong things because you did not notice what was the root cause. Now, I told you about the churchy folks of that time. Of course, it was temple. We didn't call them church. But they said he cast out that spirit by a evil spirit. Jesus had to give them some theology classes. He had to start teaching them about how a kingdom works. And it says, a kingdom divided upon itself cannot stand. All right, we're going to break that down to us. Because in our society, we have broken kingdoms. We are divided. We divide even at churches. We divide our kingdom. And one of the reasons I was ordained under the Church of God. And then someone informed me that if you are a minority, you can only be a pastor of a minority church for the Church of God. You could not be a pastor of a predominantly white church because you're a minority. Well, you happen to be a Hispanic minority, so you cannot be a minority non-Hispanic. You can't be the pastor of a black church. You can only be a pastor of a Hispanic church. I said, this doesn't sit right with me. Well, that's how it is. I said, well, we have now divided our kingdoms. And aren't we the same in Christ? Doesn't the Bible says there's neither male nor female, Jew or Gentile? But then we're going to say, hey, but when we do church, we're going to separate it. We're not going to tell the people they can't come. We're just going to tell the people, the one who's in charge, who he can't lead. So I left the Church of God. Because somewhere inside of me, that seems wrong. Well, if I lost some of you, I've watched Benny Hinn, and I've even heard him speak his native language. And do you notice? Everybody shows up. They don't say, oh, he can't lead because he can only speak to the people who are from the area of the Arabian Peninsula and the Egyptian. He can only deal with those folks. They don't do that. Kingdom of God is not divided like that. We divide ourselves like that. Now, we may have to have some division. But I assure you, the division will not be to divide. The division will be to unite. See, for instance, we have a crazy growth spurt, and we can't all fit in the same building at the same time. And we have half Hispanic that don't speak a lot of English. And we have half Americans who speak English. Y'all see a natural division there? Everybody sees one, right? Now, I want you to know the irony. If we were to say, okay, we're going to have a Spanish church and an English church, are some of the Spanish speakers going to be in the English side? Yes. Will some English speakers end up in the Spanish side? Yes. So do we have a true division? No, we don't. We don't have a true division. Because I guarantee you, when time comes for us to split, we're going to make sure not to do a split to where we're like, ooh, y'all stay over there and y'all stay over there. We had a way of solving that in Miami. You know how we did it. We had church together every 3 months. It was weird because one person spoke English, one person spoke Spanish, and the other person spoke Creole. So if the English pastor had to preach, he had to wait for the Spanish speaker to interpret, and then he had to wait for the Creole interpreter to interpret. And sometimes he got carried away. And he started speaking a little too fast. And then the one that spoke Creole would hit the one that spoke Spanish on the shoulder. And he looked at him, the one that spoke Spanish would hit the one that spoke English on the shoulder. And they all look at him like, you're going too fast. Usually the message was just like 15 minutes long. Times three. It was a unique experience. How many of you would like an experience like that for church? I think it's so cool. You know, I wonder if we could have more than three people speaking. You know, maybe we have the Japanese over here and then waiting his turn. I've had a Japanese interpreter in Japan, and every once in a while, she seemed to have been preaching her own message. Because I said something small, and then she said something really long, and I'm looking at her, I said, you saying what I'm saying? She says, yes, it's just that what you said is not something they're accustomed to, so I have to give an explanation of what you said. Well, now, what happens when a miracle happens and the rest of the folks start saying that you're doing it because of demons? Have they ever said that about your pastor? You have Lisa saying, yes, yeah, they have. They've, even one of our members that was being moved by the Holy Spirit, he ended up leaving the church because someone told him, Bishop does that because he has a lot of demon power. So Jesus spoke about a kingdom divided. This is how it works. If demons were against demons, there'll be no kingdom. Can't be that way. They'll have their own war all by themselves. We'll be out there, not even part of it. And eventually they'll destroy each other. And then we'll have no demons. Great. Fantastic. That's not how it is. They have one kingdom. They have a militia. They have rank. Now, now that I'm telling you this, some of you all of a sudden should be like, whoa, the devil's out to get me. The devil is one. And he's the one in charge. So guess what? He probably never met you. You know, you have to be causing a lot of trouble in his kingdom before you run into him, because you have to go through levels. So some of you, I want you to hear the statement and kind of learn it. New levels, new devils. You understand it? New level, new devils. See, some of you, I'm ready for this. I had one of our former members said, Bishop, I am so ready to deal with the demonic. I said, boy, you can't deal with yourself. You can't deal with yourself. How in the world you want to deal with demons? You can't do that. You got to first deal with yourself. So if you haven't dealt with yourself yet, guess how many devils you're dealing with? How many? Zero. You're not a threat. Once you start dealing with you and you go to a higher level, now you're going to start dealing with devils. Well, which one? The first level. How many of you felt you're level 10 or 20 or 30 or 40 or somewhere up there and said, no, we're just starting. We're just starting with a first level. What does the person that's in charge of the city, what does he call in the Bible? He's called a what? The ones in charge, let's say Aniston, what does he call? He's not a king. No, for in the demonic realm, what does he call? Prince. So they call him principalities. He's a prince in a demonic range. Now, see, when I start talking about demons, and everybody like, oh, my goodness gracious, this is going to be scary. Let me tell you, I'm not scared of demons. I am not. Are there those that are greater than I am? Yes, they are. But I have angels, too. God will not give me more than I'm able to bear. So God's not going to give me someone that I can't handle. Come on, some of you need to get a little encouraged here. God knows what level you are. Said if we have to have levels and we want to go to a new level, let me tell you how that new level feels like. You just got a breakthrough. Man, I just got a breakthrough. And I'm up here. And all of a sudden, I just feel all beat down. And it's like, goodness, like someone just hit me from left or right. I'm all bloodied. And I'm about to give up all over again. Anybody ever had that after getting a breakthrough? Got a breakthrough, get beat down. Why? You're in a new level now. Now you have to beat that level. It's almost like a video game. I see you coming. I know how to do, what those called, the combos? I remember when they first started doing combos. It was a Mortal Kombat. See, I'm telling you my age. Mortal Kombat was the first combo, and sit there and you had to learn how to use those four little buttons and then the joystick, this side and everything, and all of a sudden it's like, if you were fighting me, I always use the same character because I only knew the combos for one character. I didn't know the combos for everybody else, so every time I played, I was the same person. Some of us are going to have to learn some combo moves. That way, when you find out you are in a new level, you start acting like that new level and not act like the church that said, ooh, I know how what happened is that he put a spirit on me. Oh, did I say that? You got a breakthrough and all of a sudden you getting beat down and you start blaming the person who prayed for you. Oh, he put this on me. No, I didn't. You're in a new level. Act like it. I like the new level you're in. Don't fall back down and start all back over again. I've seen those people. Have any of you ever seen people that just seem to just keep going around the same bush? Isn't that sickening? And oh, here we go again, same old stuff again. Here we go again, same old stuff again. Here we go again. Oh man, enjoy new sights. Stop going around the same bush. Even though how many leaves it had and everything. You know, get to a higher level. Move up. So understand this. You get a breakthrough. What is your natural, normal thing you should feel after your breakthrough? You should feel like you're being beat down. That is natural. Do you find it in the Bible? Oh, Elijah just had a breakthrough. He just had all this water put on all this wood, and all of a sudden fire came and consumed it all. And now he's hiding and saying, Lord God, if I would only but die, why was I even born? Wait, he said stuff like that. Notice everyone that got a breakthrough in the Bible always felt pitiful afterwards. Who was the man that was sent to go and minister to the people over there and got swallowed by that fish? What was his name again? Did you notice after he had the greatest revival, he sat down under a bush and what did he do? He complained. You notice it's a pattern that you see over and over again. You got to a new level, and instead of enjoying your new level, you realize that you have more against you now. Now, more is not against you. That's just how it feels. Oh, and then whenever you start feeling crazy, you start quoting scriptures. You know, the devil don't like it. He don't like that. You know, I don't feel good. But when those who are weak say they are strong, hey, guess what? I'm strong. Oh, man. Got a little fever, but I'm strong. And every time you say you're strong, you start to feel it. You start to feel strong. And you got to get strong enough to fight that level. All right, let's use the video game again for the analogy. Your life is about to end. Your bar is almost a nothing. But you know if you find a heart, you get some of your strength back. So you start going to the game, and the moment a heart shows up, you got a little more strength now. Hey, I can't beat the big boss in this level with this amount of strength. That's not enough. This big boss is going to kill me. So guess what I got to do? I still have to go look for some more hearts. And I want to find hearts. And at the same time I'm finding hearts, I'm fighting this level and trying not to get hit. Well, it's making sense to some of us now, right? See, we put it in a game, you start to make sense. Wait a second, you mean life is a game? Oh yes, life is a game. It's a big one. Your life is a huge game. Your goal is to win it. And not only for you to win it, for you to win others. He that winneth souls is wise. I'm not worried when I go to sleep about some demon trying stuff on me. I'm not concerned about that. I've read of Wigglesworth when he went to sleep at nighttime in the middle of missions, and he'll get to bed and he'll look at that spirit right next to him. He says, move over, I'm tired. Isn't that crazy? Could you imagine having that kind of faith and that kind of authority that you're not even concerned? Just move over, man. You're taking up the whole bed. (laughs) It is by the prince of demons that he drives out demons. So who did he, they said, was running Jesus? It was the authority of the city. It was demon, the demon in charge of the city is the one that's using Jesus. We know that's not true. We also know that the demon of the city didn't even try to talk to Jesus. He was not at that level. When he was tempted by the devil. He was tempted by the number one guy. He wasn't tempted by number two and number three and number four. He was tempted by the first one that fell. Are we there? No. Bishop, are you there? No. Do you know anybody else that's there? No. Well, why aren't you there? Why aren't you? It's not, my level is not one of my design. It's the one that God wants me to go through. It's the same thing with yours. It's not of your design. You have to deal with where you are. Now, how many of you today, right now, you've had a breakthrough and the very next day you felt depressed? Look around. Come on, keep your hands up. Everybody, look around. You see, it's not something weird. It is something natural. It happens. So now that you know what happens, you get up the next day and say, no, I'm not going to lose my breakthrough. You know what? What God did, and I'm going to remember what God did. If I have to speak it to myself every day. See, because the Bible says to build yourself into your highest faith, that you have to build yourself up to your highest faith. Not that the pastor has to prime you up. Come on, build up. No, you have to get to the point. I'm pushing myself. I'm building myself up to my highest level of faith. See, and when you do that, you're going to find out after a while you've been in so many levels that you get around the people who are on level zero. By the way, there are a lot. Most people are on level zero. They have not had their first level yet. And you get around level zero demons. You know what level zero demons do? They go hide. If you're in a higher level, come on the video game. You're playing level 20. How hard is level zero? We understand it. All right, you're going to go on level zero and be able to pass it with no problem. It's like, I did this before. Level one. You get the big boss. Oh, I know how to get rid of the big boss. And then you end and the hands are up and you lost like hardly no power. Level two, level three, level four, level five. Once you've gone through the process and you end up having to minister to people who have not gone through that process, you'll find that the demons that they're dealing with have a little power. They have a little power. So that's why demons asked Jesus in one of the miracles already, can you please allow us to go to the pigs? Who's asking? The pigs. Wait, Jesus wasn't saying, can you please go into the pigs? Jesus didn't do that. It was a demon saying, can we please go into the pigs? See, I didn't mean to end up having a demonology class today. I'm just doing what God gave me. And I know this. Whenever things comes up, is because they're about to happen. Oh, I've experienced that. Things that are coming up that the Spirit is speaking, you're going to have to start experiencing it. You're going to end up going through things of, oh, I understood that. Wait a second. How come that spirit didn't even bother me? Let's go to the next one. John chapter 5. It's going to be a bit of verses here. Let me read through them. Verse 1. Sometime later, Jesus went up to Jerusalem for one of those Jewish festivals. Now there is in Jerusalem near the Sheep Gate a pool, which is in Aramaic is called Bethesda, and which is surrounded by five covered colonnades. Here a great number of disabled people used to lie, the blind, the lame, the paralyzed. One who was there had been invalid for 38 years. Keep that number in mind. 40 being a generation, 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and learned that he had been in this condition for a long time, he asked him, "Do you want to get well?" Let's stop there a second. He's been an invalid for almost a whole entire generation. And the question is asked, "Do you want to be well?" Now, I want you to understand, if you had some kind of sickness right now and someone asked you, "Do you want to be well?" what would be your normal answer? You sure? Because that's not what most of us would do, really. Most of us in here would begin to tell us our conditions and the symptoms that we have. Because that's what you do when you go to the hospital. You know, you go to the hospital to get well. Right? Does everyone who go to the hospital gets well? No. Do you know the third largest cause of death in the United States is prescribed medicines? The third, prescription medicine. No, we don't really go to the hospital to get well. We go to the hospital in hopes that we'll get well. So Jesus asks this man, "Do you want to be well?" And what does he begin to tell Jesus? Look what he says. "Sir," the invalid replied, "I have no one to help me into the pool when the water is stirred. While I'm trying to get in, someone else goes down ahead of me." Why did he say this? He said this because in his mind there was only one way to be healed. Dennis, didn't we say this already? You get in a pattern. He's been sitting there waiting to get in the water. See, once a year, an angel came and touched the water, and the water started to be moved, and the first person that'll fall into the water will be healed. Man, whoever owned that pool today will be a billionaire. I don't think some of you got it. You imagine how many people be sitting outside that pool? You know how many accidents they'll have outside that pool? Trying to get rid of all the people that are in front of you. Jesus asked them, "Do you want to be well?" He tells them his condition. Man, I am really preaching right now. See, God doesn't care what condition you're in. He wants to know if you want to come out of it. That's all. He begins to say, "Oh, well, you know, I didn't get to finish college. And, you know, I've never really had a real good job, and I'm not marketable, and, I've never made more than minimum salary, and that's why I can't get this job, because I can't help it. I've never done it." No one asks you any of that stuff. Pastor, do you ever apply for jobs that you don't qualify to? Yeah, I do. Why? Because they pay more. Have you ever gotten any of those jobs you didn't qualify for? Yeah. Well, how? I don't know. Didn't you ask? No, I didn't. Why not? Because I probably would have proved I'm not the one to get that job. So I just kept my mouth closed. And whenever they taught me something new, I never said, "Whoa. Slow down, that's new. I never heard that before." I sat there and pretended like I knew it all along. Really? Why? Because let the poor say he is rich, right? Does the rich people, do they think like poor people? Do rich people apply for stuff that they don't qualify for? I think today's message is really helpful. Because some of us end up in, see, this past week, I was looking at employment opportunities. And every time I saw $7 an hour, $8 an hour, $9 an hour, $10 an hour, I said, I can't live with that. Who can live off of that? I did the math. One of them was like $507 a week. I'm like, I have more faith than that. I said, no, that's not even worth it. I've gotten so used to thinking rich that I don't understand how the poor live being poor. I've got used to thinking that way. So here it is. If God is asking you, do you want to get well, why are you telling him all your conditions? How many of you can kind of stop and notice that you have done that? And it's that this is going on and the other going on and the next is going on. And Lord, I was born like this and you didn't want to do anything about it. And because of that, who made all of that important? And now here again, did Jesus ask him, do you have enough faith? He asked him something simple, right? Do you want to be well? I'm glad that Jesus is not like me, because I would have left that man right there. I would have. I would have found someone that I find more worthy. I would have gone to the next person and said, do you want to get well? And I would have waited for the one that said, yes. That's just me. All right? I'm glad that Jesus is not like me. Stop looking at me with that tone of voice. Y'all would do the same thing. Look at verse 8. Then Jesus said to him, get up, pick up your mat, and walk. Wait a second. Jesus just disregarded everything this man just said. Really, didn't he? Do you want to get well? Well, every time the pool is moved, someone jumps up in front of me, pick up your stuff, and go. Here's the problem. It's a Sabbath. You're not supposed to do work on the Sabbath. And he's walking around with his stuff. And he gets stopped by the church folks. Hey, what you doing? I'm going home. Put that stuff down. No, the one that healed me told me to carry it with me. Well, who is it that told you to carry it? I don't know. I just know what he told me. I knew some of you would get the comedy out of it. There's some things in the Bible that are funny. Really, I'm going to read it in Bible lingo so you can see that I didn't make it up. All right. At once a man was cured. He picked up his mat and walked. The day on which he took place was on a Sabbath. And so the Jewish leader said to the man who had been healed, it is the Sabbath. The law forbids you to carry your mat. But he replied, the man who made me well said to me, pick up your mat and walk. So they asked him, who is this fellow who told you to pick it up and walk? The man who was healed had no idea who it was, for Jesus had slipped away in the crowd that was there. See, I didn't make it up. It did really happen. Wait a second. The church people didn't care that he was healed. The church folk cared that he was carrying his mat. Doesn't that sound like churchy people today? It's like, let's forget the miracle that just happened. For 38 years, this man has been not able to get up. Now he gets up. Not only can he get up, he can get up and pick up where he was. Oh, come on. We're talking about breakthrough here. Not only did he get up, but he took up where he was. And he's walking where he was with him. Now he's taking that thing instead of that thing taking him. He's walking with it. And here are the church folks. Put that down, man. Why are you walking around with that stuff? You look silly carrying that chair. Well, the chair has been having to carry me for 38 years. Thank God I can carry the chair now. But you look so foolish doing it. Yeah, but that guy, the one that cured me, told me to carry it, so I'm carrying it. Where are you taking it to? I'm taking it home. What you going to do with it home? I'm going to put it down. Because that's dumb to carry it with me everywhere I go. So Jesus kind of escaped. He went away somewhere. And then the man runs into Jesus again. Now, I want you to know this. Jesus didn't tell him any requirement to get healed. But look what Jesus says to him now. Stop sinning or else worse is going to happen to you. Whoa. So what does the man do? He goes and finds the people that wanted to know who Jesus was. He said, that man did it. He's the one that did it. He did it. Does that happen in church too? Oh, yeah, I'll find the people that we have done the most for are the people that turn around and be our biggest pain. It ended up being that way. Why? Because Jesus meddled. He shouldn't have meddled, right? He was all in his business. Why should he be in his business? Simple. He's the one that got him to get up. That's all. The attitude of this man was one that I can tell you eventually he ended up worse. The Bible doesn't say that, but I can tell you that he did get worse eventually. Because the answer that he had given the elders was already enough. The elders didn't come back to him and said, did you find out who he was? No, he went to the elders and said, that's the one that made me break the Sabbath. Today we are learning a lot of lessons about us. It is us. I believe that these two miracles have more to do with us than others because it didn't have any requirement from the person that was being healed. No requirements at all. When God heals you of something, does God want you to fix your attitude and do better? Yeah, he does. My younger brother that lived with me and when he was dealing with Hodgkin's lymphoma, it's a cancer. He was 21 years old. They gave him 50% chance to live. If you understand the odds, that also gave him 50% chance to die. He had gotten to 80-something pounds, nothing but skin and bones and a big old lump on his neck. He was going with me every Sunday to church, and God healed him. It was a miracle. His lump just went down. All in within a matter of 10 minutes. Went back to the hospital. No sign of cancer. He must be the one that's in church the most, right? He's the one on Facebook, you know, he's always saying something Christian, right? No, he doesn't go to church. And boy, you say something Christian, he'll be the first one to stand up against what you said. Why? It's human nature. Don't get into my business. You know why I get in trouble as a pastor? Because I know your business. I know your business. I get in trouble. Shh, don't say anything. If God shows you, you pretend you don't see anything. When we had our first building, so I can tell you about our first building we had. On Sunday before service, you'll see the youth at the pulpit. They're crying out to God. And one Sunday, I decided to listen to their prayer. So I got close to them. And their prayer went something like this. God, please don't let Pastor see what I did. Whoa. One Sunday I was in San Diego, California. No service. I called one of our young people. And I said, when I get there, I need to see you two in my office. Got back there in the office. you know, guy and girl. I'm in San Diego. How do I know? Because God showed me while it was happening. Don't you think God knows? I'm just a person. I don't know everything. But God does show me some things. But God knows everything. So if God healed you of something and God says, stop doing that. How do I know God said it? Because you start feeling it. You start feeling like, I need to stop doing this. And then you come back later on. I did it again. Father, forgive me. Why I keep doing this? Why? Here's why. We end up taking that little mat that you were healed from, and we start using the mat again. But we start using it to try to cover so no one else sees what we're doing. See, every time we do something wrong, we do it in hiding. We go where no one knows us. See, I was just in Amsterdam a few weeks ago. If I'm not in Amsterdam, it has the largest red light district in the world. Well, what does that mean? It has the most prostitutes. And guess who are their clients? Are the tourists. They're not the people from Amsterdam. It's the people that fly to Amsterdam. So I want you to know some of the people that fly to Amsterdam for that. They're the attorneys. They're the doctors. They're the politicians. And get ready for this one. They're the pastors. We start to hide out. Well, what does God want us to do? Find someone that can help us through it. Yo, man, I'm having issues right now. I want to do something that I am not supposed to do. I'm on my way. I'll be there in 15 minutes. You mean to tell me that's how God wants us to do? Yes, the Bible says, bear one another's burdens. That's in the Bible. Come here, Elizabeth. Elizabeth is really tiny, so this is really easy to do. All right, Elizabeth, you lean on me. Come on, put all your weight on me. Okay, all right, I can carry Elizabeth because she's tiny. Man, I can pick her up and walk with her, no problem. Now, wait a second. All right, Elizabeth, can I do the same thing for you? Here is where we go wrong when we do start to get people that can be responsible. We go to the person who is not able to bear what we have. Come on. So I need to grab a hold of someone that can carry my weight. I need someone, hey, I need to lean on you. Wait, all I have is Elizabeth. And I have Evelyn. Come on up here, Evelyn. That's all I have. I just have, and I can't help that they're tiny. But together, the two tiny people can bear me. The two tiny people can bear me a little, you know. And do we understand this? See, so when you're going through, God is not expecting you to go through by yourself. Thank you, ladies. God expects you to use what you have. You're getting beat down by the enemy. Guess what? We're ready for warfare. Come on, bring it on. You go to someone who is able to help you through that and said, I'm having issues. Here's the problem. We still get really religious in church. And we don't understand. We live in a real world. See, I went to church one time, and the guy that was the psalmist, he did praise and worship. He got up, and he told the church that he's been having problems with pornography. He sat there in front of the whole church and told the church, I've always battled with pornography. I'm still dealing with issues of pornography. Guess what the church did? They sat him down. I wouldn't have sat him down. Oh, you agree with having issues with her. No, I think it took everything in him to get in front of everybody again and acknowledge that. So what we're supposed to do now is help bear his burden, help carry him. And when they sat him down, I went up to him. I said, listen, you have that problem? Call me whenever you're having issues. We'll go out, we'll do something, we'll go bowling, we'll go watch a movie, well, you know, we'll do something, we'll go off a coffee, we'll do something. We'll spend the time until when your strength comes back. And he called me a few times. And the church finally restored him when they had to go sing in another church. Come on, y'all following the mess that we do. If someone tells you they're junk, it's not for you to announce it to everybody else. It's not for you to come out with a rollout banner. Oof, look what he has done. He said it to me himself. That's not what it's for. I'm telling you because he's trying to find some strength. We're supposed to have strength together. The Bible tells us about a cord being all by itself is weak, but let that cord have some other parts. That's how rope is. Rope gets its strength not from one strand. It gets its strength from the multiple strands. And then those multiple strands are then kind of reinforced by other multiples of strands. So if we're being the actual church, which enemy can come against us? You can't really. You try. Let some guy walk in here and try to hurt Elizabeth. You know, Elizabeth doesn't have a concern in the world if somebody's going to try to walk in and hurt her. You know why? Because you have her dad in the back and you have me in the front. And then we have some men in between. Not only that, we have some women. My wife is violent. You think I'm violent? Don't mess with her. You try to tickle her, and there's been many times that I thought we'll never have offsprings. Because she's like, stop! I'm like, all I did was try to tickle you. She's violent. See, we work better together. I wasn't doing well in my calculus class. So you know what I did? I found someone who's good at calculus. And I went to them, I said, I don't understand this. And they looked at me and said, you? Yeah, me. I don't understand this. Oh, okay. Let's get rid of this junk and this junk and this junk and this junk, that, this junk, this junk. None of that is important. Let's go down here to the basic part. This is what's important. So every time you have a problem, get rid of all the junk. And I'm like, this woman is crazy. She took away everything I had to do in the problem and went down to a basic problem. I'm like, I know the answer to that. That's two. That's the answer to the whole problem. What? Why did they do all this other stuff? I don't know why they did all this stuff. I just learned to get rid of the junk. So I went and took the calculus class at Gadsden State. And come find out, I already took that class. That was an easy A, right? I know this. Got rid of all the junk. This is easy. Why are they making it so hard at JSU? Ready, took the class. We have, everyone in here has to lean on somebody else. Here is where we go wrong. Wives, you decide to lean on your husband. Husband, you decide to lean on your wife. Mistake number one and mistake number two. Why? What gender is the wife? She is what? Female. So you as a male, you're going to understand the female. Are you? All right. Husbands, what gender are the husbands? Male. So your wife is going to understand the male. See, what we do as married people, we speak to each other, but we don't pull from each other. We speak to each other, but we don't pull from each other. I don't pull strength from my wife, and my wife doesn't pull strength from me, because we are opposites. So what do you have to do, Pastor? I have to find godly men that can give me godly counsel. Yes, your pastor does go to other people when he needs some answer. But I have to do like we did with Elizabeth. I can't go to one of my pastors. I have to go to those who have more authority. Here's why. If I have an issue and it's serious and I tell one of my pastors, guess what one of my pastors is going to tell? They're going to find someone else. They don't mean to. It just becomes too much of a burden. It just becomes too heavy that they can't carry it by themselves. So they now need someone to help them with that load. And eventually it gets to the wrong person. No, I am not living in sin. If any of you are already went there, no, I'm not. I'm just using my analogy. But I do have pastors that I do go to in case. And what we do is every once in a while we'll go out to eat to keep those communication open. Just in case I need them. Well, guess what those pastors do with me? They do the same thing. I am having this problem. We're sharing one another's burdens. And then I don't go home and tell my wife what the pastor told me he's dealing with. That's with us. We're bearing each other's burdens. My wife has friends who are female too that she can share with. But then she also got to be careful of the size of person she shares it with. Which means she has friends that are not here. Are we understanding this? All right, men, some of us, we like doing the facade. We like acting like, I got everything together. But eventually, you'll falter. Eventually, you'll fall apart. Every person needs somebody. Everybody does. Moms, your kids need you for a time. Then it'll come the time they won't go to you. And then that's when you start praying, Lord God, give them good friends. Give them friends that'll give them good counsel. Because after a while, they're not going to go to mom. After a while, they're not going to go to dad. You see, it's a pattern. How come when we get to church, we act like it's brand new? It's not new, is it? It is something that we do in society. Our women started having a women meeting. And our women started having breakthroughs. I dare tell you they've had more breakthroughs in the women's meeting than they've had coming to church on Sunday. How about if I show up in the next women's meeting? The dynamic will change right away, wouldn't it? It'll become I don't know. We can't say this in front of Pastor. We don't want him to think weird of us. Men, we get together. We don't say a thing. That's how we minister to each other. Let's kill the fish. That's what we do when we go fishing. Let's kill the deer. That's what we do when we go hunting. Men, we find togetherness by killing something. It's true. some of y'all looking at me like, that's not, it's true. When you go fishing, I am not the one that throws the fish back. I find that a waste of time. I'm thinking, hey, I have a family that will love this fish. That little law that is too small to throw back, man, I have to fight myself every time I catch something too small. I want your mama. Bring me your mama. We bond doing stuff like that. You know, let's go race a car. Let's tear something up. That's how men are. And that's how we talk to each other. We don't say, hey, dude, I need help. Let's go punch something. Get your aggression out. And when you finish, you're like, you feel better. Don't you feel better after you catch a few fish? And not all men do that, by the way. There's some men that have to find another outlet. And if we don't know their outlet, we got to discover their outlet. And we're speaking volumes by not saying a word. Women, y'all didn't know that about men, right? They can speak without saying a word. You know, like if a guy came in and looked at your daughter. Let's say a 30-year-old guy walks in the door and sees my 14-year-old girl and he starts oogling her. I'm going to speak. Y'all heard that language? Did you read between the lines? What did I say between the lines? I'm going to hurt you. Spoken language. Understood. Every man that saw it would have understood it. Not only that, I would have some men that would join in the conversation. If they saw me looking at a guy a little funny, and they looked, and then they saw me looking at my daughter looking back at the guy, they will turn around from where they are and look. Right? Now, what happened to that conversation? The conversation went from I will beat you up to we will beat you up. You're in trouble in here. You want to start some mess with one of our young girls. So, men, we do speak to each other. So, women, when you say, they didn't say anything. How many of the ladies got to see men together and you thought we didn't say anything? All right, we have Donna back there. She's been married longer than everybody else in here. She raised her hand. And you say a word. Yeah, we did. We speak men. We do. We speak men. And it's a language that our teenagers, they're starting to learn right now. They use the word colloquially. We're filling each other out. So understand. We're here to minister to one another. We're here to not being so churchy. If you see someone get healed, man, make a big deal about their healing, not the mat they're carrying. Come on, don't do the usual. If you get to a new level and you experience that you're getting beat down, let me tell you, grab some help. I'm in a new level. Yes. So I have new devils. Yes. Help me go through this stage quickly. How many of you have done that on video games? Come on, join me on this game here. Now they can do it online. Before we couldn't do it online, you had to stick a quarter in there. All right, I'm in here with you. Now you can go online. Hey, I need some help on this level. Hey, I'm here. And now they can talk to each other over the internet. Good night. Don't we need to do that as a church? I'm fighting this new enemy. He's new. Come on, bring your special weapon. I got you covered. I brought my sword. I'm ready. Come on. I'm well experienced in martial arts. I got the sword of the Spirit. I got the word of God. I have my shoes prepared by the gospel of peace, my helmet of salvation, the breastplate of faith. Oh, I'm ready. Come on, buddy. I'm a ninja. See, when we're hearing this, and I'm glad it's a little funny, but at the same time, I think God wants us to go through new levels daily. Can you imagine what that'll feel like? Every day a new level. See, the Bible says this about God. He goes from glory to glory. Wait, God is still increasing? So why not us? Why aren't we increasing? Why aren't we walking in the room and the devils are starting to say, ooh, can I, we please go somewhere else? Why is that not happening? I think it should.